I'm out tracking caribou today. The caribou is the same species as the reindeer of Europe and Asia. Well, thank goodness I'm not one of the early settlers that had to hunt their meat instead of just dropping by the local supermarket. Well, of course, the settlers were just delighted when they shot something as big as a caribou. It meant that they wouldn't have to hunt for a while, and they had more time for quilting. Well, from the looks of this quilt, a caribou crossed right across this quilt. Now, caribou tracks are distinguished by widely separated crescents. It was probably out looking for some tasty tundra, mushrooms, or grasses, and he must have felt right at home among the pine tree quilt blocks. Well, this quilt would look great anywhere, in your mountain or vacation cabin, or in your country living room. The various shades of green in the trees brings the fabric forest to life. And then the plaid border finishes it off with just that homespun touch. Today we're going to honor the caribou, a source of clothing for the settlers, as well as for food. Meanwhile, I'm going to keep an eye out for grizzly bears, their chief predator. But let's do make some progress on the Bears in the Woods quilt. First, I'll show you how to make the pine tree block for your quilt. And then we'll continue getting ready for the holidays by turning four tree blocks into a tree skirt with caribou crossing through the snow. Join me for some holiday fun. Getting nippy outside. It feels like fall. And this quilt looks like fall. Oh, it's just great in all the autumn colors. Now, Teresa made this, and when she quilted it, she stitched in the ditch around each one of the pine trees and then stippled in the background to create that raised effect. And then she set all 20 blocks together with lattice and cornerstones. Oh, it's just great in the autumn colors. Now, can't you just smell those leaves burning? Now, if you're making a full-size Bears in the Woods quilt, you'll need to make 20 tree blocks. For those 20, you need to have 10 different quarter yard cuts of green. And oh, when you get those fabrics, make sure to vary the scales and the colors. Just think about the forest so you can put an interesting tree together. And from each one of these pieces, cut two 2-inch strips. And oh, you'll have plenty left over for your miniature quilt. Now take those 2-inch wide strips and lay them up right side up on your cutting mat. And actually, I have 5 stacked up here in each one of the stacks, and boy, I'm going to do some fast cutting. I want to get those trees cut into that scale. You want to go from the widest up to the narrowest top. So just take your square up ruler and line that up right in the selvage edge. Ooh, let me get rid of that selvage. Just won't work in the quilt. So trim off those edges. Just take these, get rid of them, and then cut your bottom branch of the tree. And the bottom width is 9.5 inches. So just line that up, 9.5. I'm cutting 10 at a time right here. Ooh, pretty good. Moving over, the next branch is 8 inches. Move those, just going right down that stack. Let me see if I can get the next one. Is 6.5. I need to have a 5-inch right here. And as soon as that one's done, there is only one more branch, and ooh, can I get it at 3.5 inches. Perfect. Now, all I want to do is just work with my background fabric. I already cut it and have it laid out. Now, all of the branches for the tree right here are 2-inch strips as well, and they get smaller at the bottom, go wider to the top. The first one was cut at 3 3/4 inches, 4.5, oh, keep on going, 5 1/4, 6, and then 6 3/4. And right in the middle, I'm going to put the different size pieces of green that I cut. Oh, you are going to see a tree coming to shape right here. Stack those all up, one more piece. Now the top and the bottom row are actually wider. Those are cut at 2 1/4 inches. That's just for a little leeway. That's for squaring up later. And then the trunk is also cut and ready to go. You need to have 2 6-inch wide background strips, and go ahead and select two different trunk colors, 2-inch strips of each of those. Now, I'm ready to mark. Gonna do some diagonal sewing. This is the best part. Oh, let me just go ahead and throw these over here quick so I've got lots of space. I'm gonna take two of the background rows, all cut, and put them wrong side up on my gridded mat. And just square them, make them completely square on the mat. Now I want to mark diagonal lines on all of these rows, so I'm going to use my 6-inch square. Perfect. You just line up the 45-degree line right where the two meet together, right where they're butt together. Drop the diagonal line right down through there, and then with a very sharp, soft pencil, mark diagonal lines up and down. Ooh, and let me just stack these up, and you just keep on going right down through each one of these pieces, drawing diagonal lines. Ooh, let me draw one more for you, make it a little darker. I'm gonna go back through all of my background rows, draw my diagonal lines, and I'll be ready for sewing. I have a forest of trees to sew together. Now I did all of my diagonal line marking on the end of the background strips. And when I marked, it was in this direction. I went up and down so that the lines look like this. Actually, the peak is at the top. But when you want to sew the rows together, you literally take these strips and turn them so that they're upside down. Now the points all go down. Now take this piece, this is for the right side of the tree, and you literally place it on the right. All of these angles are going down. The opposite side also going down. Now I want to show you how to sew the top row that is actually a 3.5-inch piece of the green. Now when you place this, the green is right side up, the background strips are wrong side up, and it's positioned so that you can literally just take this piece, rotate it down around, and it's ready for sewing. Now some people really like to just take this piece right here, match it up, and then pin it. And if you are going to pin, you need to keep your pin out of that diagonal line so you don't get it caught in that. Now when you sew, you want to center your needle and use a multi-purpose foot. This is the best foot if you want to use this one, because it has this straight line going right down through the middle, and then you line up this straight line right with the pencil line as you sew along. Keep you in good order. Now I have 15 stitches to the inch set on my sewing machine. Needle is centered, and oh boy, I am ready for some sewing. Okay, you want to just drop it right underneath your foot so that the needle is right in the end of that diagonal line. Hold those threads, step on the gas. Ooh, if I can just sew straight, red thread, perfect. Okay, and once you have one finished, then just go ahead, pick up the next set and butt it right on behind. Now actually, if you want to pin, that's fine, but boy, pinning is not for me. It seems to always get my work distorted, and I prefer to do it without pins. Now you just keep on going basically down the right side of the tree. Each time pick that piece up, line it up, start sewing on that diagonal line. Boy, let me line that up. And your stiletto really helps to hold that as you go through. Now, gone down through three of them. I'll just go ahead and show you on these examples. Okay, fold them so that they look like this. Take your 6x6 or your 6x12, but line your 1/4-inch line right on the stitching. And then just trim away. Ooh, better get that pin out of there. That'll dull your blade for sure. And just trim off all of those triangles. Now, I know, you think I'm gonna say, and get rid of this. But my foremothers taught me, waste not, want not. And I have a little trick I wanna show you with those. Just a minute. Okay, now let's take these. They do need to be pressed. And you just drop them on the mat. And first, set the seam. Just set those stitches. And then lift the top piece up and just press right into that seam. You don't want to get any folds or any tucks at each one of these pieces. And actually, this is an assembly line pressing as well, because they're still chained all together. Now, once you have them, cut them apart like this. Stack them up exactly as they were and watch. Once again, now the background piece is wrong side up. All you're going to do is just take this piece, just turn it around like that, and it's ready for sewing. Get it lined up on the outside edges, and I'll just show you how to sew on one sample right now. By this time, boy, you should be rolling. You know, there are 20 trees in this quilt, and actually, if you would just do a quilt with only the 20 trees, it would be a double bed size quilt. That is a pretty big quilt. So you've got some sewing to do here, but boy, what a great tree quilt you're gonna have. All right, just on the one sample, I'll show you right here. I have my stitching right along there on the diagonal line. Line up your quarter inch line, trim off that tip, save that for some good stuff later. And then just take this, lay it on your mat, set the seam, lift that up, and carefully press it over. Now, if I'm lucky, this is going to be a straight line the whole way across. So let's take a good look. Maybe I better look first. Okay, exactly what I wanted. Straight line across the bottom, and then right up here you can see the quarter inch seam I have right along here. Going to work great. Now I'm going to go back, do all of my diagonal line sewing on the rows, and then we'll go on. The settlers liked their trunks long and straight because it was easier to build log cabins. Boy, I like mine straight too. Now, this is the 6-inch background strip that I added on both sides of that 2-inch trunk. And then once this piecing is done, then you just press those seams in towards the trunk. You have two different colors of trunks, and since you have 20 trees, you actually need to make 10 of each one of them, and those are 2-inch strips. Couldn't be easier. Now go ahead and divide out your trunks so that you have two sets of 10 each. Now I already have one set of trunks here, and then you want to start getting your strips organized so that you end up with trees in multiple colors. So to do that, first place every color right side up. This is one color of a trunk. Then go and right into the second one and place it. And actually, I went back and I pressed in some creases right down the center of my trees. Goes a lot better. And once you have them in place so that each color is in order, then go back, leave the top row the same. But on this row, go ahead to the bottom, pull out the bottom one, put it on the top. Go down to the next one, pull out the bottom two, put that on top, and so on down so that you start creating that variety. Oh, right here, I need to have three in a row, all different. Okay, so now once you have each one of them done, I still didn't finish the last one, go ahead and take this row and flip it right sides together to the top row. Flip the fourth row right sides together to the third. Flip this one right sides together. And then the bottom one goes right sides together to the trunk. So it's actually every other row, and you can do some assembly line sewing. This is going to be good. Take up the top piece. Actually, that's the background, and then that top row right sides together. And this time, this is going to be the most critical part of the row. You want to match up the outside edges, get that all lined up, and then use a quarter of an inch seam. Actually, I need to move my needle over just a bit. It was centered before. Okay, now I have a perfect quarter inch seam. Line that up at the one end, match it on the opposite end, and right here, we want our stitches to go right across that V. This is going to be perfect. That's why you need to have that perfect quarter of an inch. And as you get into it, use your stiletto to hold that top piece down. Get that all lined along there. And then all you want to do is just go to the next piece in the stack, pick it up, it's all set to go, and butt it right on behind. Ooh, let me see if I can just get that started at least, because you're going to just keep on assembly line sewing first the rows, and then you're going to sew each of the rows together until you have one whole tree. Let me see if how I did on that. Lift that up. Oh, it's looking good. Just like that. Okay, I'm just going to go back, keep on sewing each one of my pieces together until I get a block that looks like this. Now, each one of the pieces are lined up through the center. You can see that crease matching up. And then on the wrong side, you can take 10 of them and press the seam towards the top, and take another 10 and press the seam away from the top. As soon as I get more sewn, I'll show you how to square them up. When you're finished with your 20 tree blocks for your Bears in the Woods quilt, then just jump into the holiday spirit and create a beautiful tablecloth for the holidays. It's easy to do just with 4 tree blocks, 1 12 and a half block for the one right in the center, and then 1 large square that's cut into 4ths on both diagonals for the triangles. Now comes the moment you've been all waiting for. What to do with those pine tree trimmings and your leftover scraps? Well, I had a great time creating these tree ornaments just out of the leftovers, and they're named out of patterns right from the past. This particular one is called Geese in Flight, and oh, you can see those geese are flying south for the winter. And the other 3 are just star patterns, the 8-pointed star, the wandering star after the moving pioneers, and also the morning star. They're great fun to do. Well, when the settlers moved into their new homes, they had to spend so much time chopping down the trees. Oh, that wasn't fun. But cutting down the Christmas tree was their favorite job of all. Now, when you get started, make sure to square up your blocks to 12 and a half inches. This is the perfect time for using the turnable. It works so well. Now, when you place your 12 and a half inch square up ruler, make sure you place 6 1/4 right here on the seam in the center, and then up here 6 1/4 right along the tip of the tree. That way, then it'll be a perfectly square block. Okay, so with the turnable, just trim 2 sides, get rid of those little scraps, and then just without picking up the block or the ruler, completely turn it around so you now have the ruler in the perfect position, and you can just go back and trim those last 2 sides. Ooh, it just works great. Now, the 18-inch square ruler, the square is so large that it's a little hard to cut on the diagonal. So what I like to do is actually take that 18-inch square and press it into 4ths. Just fold it and press it, and then you can see, once you've got it pressed, that you can use those lines to cut that into 4ths. Actually, the ruler won't stretch across the whole way. So cut it once on that one fold, and then you just need to open it up and trim. Just cut right through on those remaining folds. Ooh, that's looking good. Nice big pieces, and I'm sure this is gonna be perfect for just fusing some caribou right on there. Let me get that cut too. Now, once you have all of your units ready to go, just turn your 4 tree blocks so that 4 of them are all pointing in towards the center into that 12 and a half inch square right in the middle. This is looking good. Now, those triangles are perfect for the caribou. So just go ahead and take your caribou pattern and trace it onto the paper side of webbed fusing. I did all my tracing already. And then just place your fusing right on the wrong side of the fabric. And then follow your manufacturer's instructions, because each one is different. You don't want to fuse this in place too long, or else you can't peel that paper away. Now we'll find out if I can get that peeled off. Actually have one already trimmed. Just trim around on the lines, and then once you have that trimmed on the lines, then you just go ahead, peel it. There's the fusing on the back side. Ooh, this is looking good. So you can actually get it centered right on the triangle. It's easier to go back and do some stitching. You want to do a blanket stitch. You might want to do a zigzag stitch. That looks good. Make sure you've got your seam allowance here. Just hold that down, fuse that in place, and then if you want to go ahead and give her some tracks. Oh, this is probably the female caribou, don't you think? The female caribou would always run ahead of the others. Sometimes there were like 10,000 caribou in a herd, all running together, but the females like to get a head start, run to the tundra, and then deliver their babies. So you could go ahead and fuse that right in the back, put some tracks there. Now, this piece is just going to go right in here and finish it off. Now I can put caribou on all of them. I'll sew the vertical rows together, and then I'll show you how to add the borders. It's fun to sew this together on the serger because it goes so quickly. I've been working on the borders and I'd like to show you what I've been doing. I started with the folded border, and the folded border is a 1¼-inch strip that's been folded wrong sides together, and then when you add it to the quilt top you match the raw edges and then you stitch less than a 1/4-inch seam and 10 stitches per inch, a long stitch, so that you don't have any puckers. Next I cut 4 3½-inch border strips, and off of each end I cut a 12½-inch piece, and those 12½-inch pieces I sewed to the end of each one of the four blocks. And then you need to find a 12½-inch square ruler with a 45-degree line on it and just turn it so that you line up that 45-degree line right along the stitching line. Ooh, get that lined up good. That's all right there. Okay, and then just trim off that angle at the 45-degree line. The opposite side is done exactly the same way. Just flip the ruler. And then once you have all of the tree blocks trimmed, then you go back and you add the rest of that long strip onto all four of the pieces. And then in the corner, this is exactly what it looks like right along here. You see that angle? And then it's just one more trim and the whole border is completed. Ooh, I love it. I wanted to show you how to do those tree ornaments because they are fun too. Well, I took all of those little tails that I'd been trimming off of my pine trees and I assembly line sewed them together with a scant 1/4-inch seam. And the size of this is actually just a little larger than 1¼-inches. So I want to square this up to 1¼. I took a piece of static pattern paper and cut a 1¼-inch square and then cut it once on the diagonal and peeled away the static paper. Now this is what I used for my template. I just put it right in the end of a small square up. And you just take this, oh, this is great, and just line up that pattern so that you just barely see the stitching right along there, and then trim on one side. And once you've trimmed on one side, turn it and just trim off the corners on both sides. And then you should get perfect 1¼-inch squares. Take this piece and either press it with the iron or finger press it open. You know, by the time you do your pine tree, you should have 200 of those little squares. What a bunch of ornaments you can make. Now, this particular one right here, the Wandering Star, the squares on the corners are 2 2½-inch squares cut in the diagonal. You can see the P squares right here. Now this one, different layout. This is Morning Star. The square right in the center is 2¼-inches. You want to sew the pairs together first. Now the backing is just great fun. I didn't want to do all that hand stitching. So you literally take a piece that's 3¾ by 3 inches and then just hem the two sides like this. And then once they are hemmed, you just place them right sides together to the patchwork, but you overlap them in the center, and then cut a piece of cotton batting. This is around 3¼-inches square, and place it next to the patchwork. And then you can just roll and turn that whole piece at one time. Now you might as well go ahead and insert your ribbon right in the middle so that you can sew that down too, or go ahead and fasten it off with jute at the same time. It just makes a great tree ornament. Well, I'm wondering what other projects I can do with those pine tree trimmings. Melissa and Amber have a few more projects to show you using the trimmings from the pine trees. Now, Melissa took them and she's been turning them into some beautiful Christmas cards. She just glued that triangle right on there. And Melissa, I just love the way you use the scissors and cut that edge along there. It's cute.
Thanks.
Now, will you show me how to work that punch?
Sure.
Ooh, muscle girl. Great. And so then you just create a little Christmas tree right on the card. Perfect. Now, Amber is busy gluing up a wreath. I love it, Amber. First, we took a 16-inch background square, and then Amber drew a 9-inch circle right in the middle. She's been gluing down each one of those pieces, and I love the way you're putting those poinsettias in there. You do good work, Amber.
Thank you.
Well, I'm finishing up on my tree skirt, just sewing some pearls in place. This is the exact same design as the tablecloth, only I cut a circle, a 9-inch circle right out of the middle, and then did the seam right down along here. And ooh, I love those caribou walking through the frozen tundra. Well, may you too enjoy making the majestic pine tree block create some magic with your family this Christmas.